So we are back with the that year there, what we were discussing in the last week where we started, that is called a radiation pyrometer. So we had mentioned that the radiation pyrometer is an instrument which is used to measure temperature at higher level, that is in the range of say 2000 degrees Celsius or even 6000 degrees Celsius or above or like this there. And more important thing is that this temperature ought to be measured from a distance. So it is really a non-invasive type instrument. It does not intrude into the measurement system. So it is measurement of a distance there. And you know that the basic principle we have already mentioned, that a hot body emits some electromagnetic radiation. That is the what we had. We know this one, that emits the electromagnetic radiation. And for explaining this one, the electromagnetic radiation from a hot body, we normally express two terms. One is called R of T, is called a total radiant flux density. In watt per meter square at a temperature capital T. That means a body which is is at capital T temperature, it is radiating some radiation, and total radiation per unit area is denoted as RT, which is called a total radiant flux density. Apart from that, this of R lambda T is basically that is called a spectral radiant flux density. Because this radiation is also dependent upon the and the wavelength. It is dependent on the temperature as well as the what is the wavelength it is radiating. That is the also another factor. So basically, if we look at it, if it is an its unit is watt per meter cube. That means from a wavelength of lambda to lambda plus d lambda, during this wavelength window, in this wavelength window, what is the radiation per unit area? And obviously, this R of T is equal to 0 to infinity R of lambda T into d lambda. That means if we integrate over all the wavelengths, then we get it this sort of relationship. We get total radiant flux density there. And we know also, we have also defined a black body. That is a theoretical conception which we have already, we know this one. So a black body is that whatever radiation falls on it, it is neither transmitted nor reflected. All the radiation absorbed and it increases the temperature. So black body is a theoretical conception, but from this one, actually several theoretical expressions and etc. have been developed. And this for a black body, if it is a black body, then we denote a B term, R B T, R B lambda T, or like this for this black body. And we know also the Planck's law. Is given by that is for a black body, the radiant flux density Rb lambda t is equal to C1 lambda to the power minus 5 divided by e to the power C2 by lambda t minus 1. So this was the expressions, and we are told that earlier it was actually minus 1, you can easily ignore for all practical purposes. So we can call it a, in that case it is known as Wien's law. So that is a area, and this C1 is a, and C2 are constants, and C1 is given by 3.7413 into 10 to the power minus 16 watt meter square. And C2 is given as 1.4388 into 10 to the power minus 2 millikelvin. So these are the two things they are alike. So incidentally, if I plot this Rb lambda t for different temperature and also for different wavelength, it will look like this here. It will look like this. There would be a peaking and there would be, it would be falling down like this there. And obviously this is for black body, and this is also actually a representative figure. So as the temperature increases, the intensity of radiation or spectral radiant flux density increases, and also as the wavelength increases, we can see that it increases, the spectral radiant flux density increases and goes down. But one more thing is also there, that is the maximum radiation is in IR range, that is infrared range. Why do you say it? Because we know what is the visible spectral range. What is that one? It is very small, 0.2 to 0.63 micrometer. So if you look at it, it is only a small window which we just, this is your visible range there. And below this wavelength, we call it in ultraviolet, and beyond this, this we call it infrared. So most of the radiations we receive is actually in the infrared range. While we see only our color or like this, whatever we see, it is only in the very narrow band of wavelength, that is in the 0.4 to 0.63 area. So most of the EA is in infrared range there. And also one more thing is also there, that it can be theoretically established that that this lambda max is the wavelength at which the radiation is maximum. Is maximum. In that way, it can be shown that this lambda max into T, mind it, all T are in Kelvin. The temperature all are in Kelvin. This is always a constant, and this is it is equal to 2898 micrometer into Kelvin. So that's an interesting property. So the higher the temperature, so there would be lambda max will be reducing. That's why we get some sort of curve like this there. And the second thing is that if we integrate, we know that this for a black body, RBT, that is a radian flux density, is an integration of 0 to infinity RB lambda T d lambda. If we integrate this one and using some tricks or like this, we can get it as sigma T to the power 4, where that means if we integrate over all the wavelength, and this is known as Stefan Boltzmann's law. And this sigma is equal to given as 5.67 into 10 to the power minus 8 watt meter to the power minus 2 into Kelvin to the power minus 4. So this is your constant, or like this there. So we can see there are two things, basic two equations are involved. One is the Planck's law, that is this one, and another is Stefan Boltzmann's law, that is that this is equal to sigma T to the power 4. That is, the radiant flux density is dependent upon the wavelength, while the spectral radiant flux density is dependent on the wavelength, while the from the Stefan Boltzmann's law, we can say that this is totally independent of the wavelength, because if we have already integrated it over the whole range like this, and this is a nice area. So these are the two basic properties of our laws there, which we use for this one. But before I go further for the measurement techniques, there is one more catch, that is, so this is the wavelength. You can see as the wave temperature increases, this is a intensity also increases there, okay. And you can see only in this range wavelength, we can see it is visible. That's why most of the radiations are not visible to us there. One more thing is also there, that is a black body, what we have mentioned. It's a theoretical concept, so naturally it is not a practical idea. So we can give certain bodies or like this, some make some black body coating or like this there, so that it behaves almost like a black body there. But most of the practical radiating objects, which we are called as gray body. It's a gray body there. So you can say that for a gray body, it is R of lambda T is equal to epsilon lambda into RB of lambda t. So for a practical radiating object, this will be a, there would be a multiplication factor. It is called emissivity. Which is less than one. So basically, for a practical radiating object or a gray body, whatever is the theoretical limit, but this is an emissivity there, it has to be multiplied by a factor which is less than one. It's a positive factor, of course, which will be here there. And we'll see afterwards also this creates. The emissivity creates a lot of problem for calibrations and accurately measurement these things there. And also because emissivity or epsilon lambda depends on many things. One, material property of the radiator. Second is wavelength, that means what is the surface, what is the color and all other things there. Second is wavelength. And the third is temperature. So these are the very uncertain area, but it has been observed that these very this depends upon so many things, and in fact it is very difficult. So from theoretical equations and etc. we can do say something, but actual experimentation are doing that one. It is very difficult to guess a value of practical value of emissivity. We can think of okay 0.6, 0.7 or like this, but very difficult to get exact value because they depend upon the temperature, surface and all other things here. Sometimes we try to give a black body coating or something like this so that they behave as nearly to a black body, so that emissivity factor is very close to one. But still then there is always some uncertainty. So what we can say, first of all, these are the things there. Now we can go for the measurement techniques. How do you use these two laws? Stefan Boltzmann's law or the Planck's law. Okay. So we see that two things are there. One is the Stefan Boltzmann's law. It was RBT is equal to sigma t to the power 4. Another is the Planck's law, which we have already given that one. So Planck's law is that RB lambda t is equal to C1 lambda to the power minus 5 divided by e to the power C2 by lambda t minus 1. It was like this. So now what we can do is that two kinds of techniques we can measure. That is that one using the Stefan Boltzmann's law, that means you take that complete wavelength spectrum and find out over the all the spectral area what is the amount of radiation. That means over all the spectrum wavelength, so they accumulate, and if we absorb in a body or like this there, if we just come to this one, we'll see that we'll absorb those radiation, and say suppose the temperature of that body which is measuring that one will increase. Just a very crude example for doing this one is that if you come bring your hand near your hot body, your temperature of that skin increases because it absorbs, it receives radiation from that hot body and it is absorbed here, and this heat absorption will cause the temperature. So this one, it is independent of whatever is the wavelength or all the things there, because it constitutes of all the wavelength. That's why we call it is that one is a broadband technique. Okay, so it is like this. Okay, you when a fire, you just feel, put your hand nearby and see how is the temperature, and like this of your screen, how does your screen, your skin says, and accordingly guess some temperature. That is a standard way for guessing that temperature, or like this if it is not possible to touch. So from a distance itself, like this, and that is independent of all the temperatures, of the wavelength. Another one is that is called narrow band. What is narrow band? Narrow band means, okay, you put a, in the, you receive the radiation and you put a filter. You put a filter which will pass only the radiations in this range there and measure the intensity of the radiation. Measure the intensity of the radiation. Because we have seen that the temperature of the, as the temperature increases, the wavelength pattern also do change like this there, and we will get more and more, because we must have seen that as the as a hot object is there, and you consider your eye as a detector, which is a, of course it is having a very limited, we know, wavelength window there. So you must have also seen that the, for the, if the temperature increases, so we start from the temperature of an iron body or some like this, the temperature goes, the color of goes from red hot to white hot like this there. So basically red, because of the red is the maximum wavelength, that is 0.63, there you will find in that wave range it is increasing, or if it is far more, if it is too high, then it is almost all the wavelength, it is coming there, so it will be almost wide. So basically in a broad band you would be measuring a, what we will call it, you would be using a thermal detector. I will come to that one like this afterwards. And here, for a narrow band, we require an optical detector. That means a some photo detector or this sort of detector, which is all sensitive and frequency dependent, or the wavelength dependent, like this here. So what we can say that the broadband measurement the scheme, we can say like this, we can say that we put some body, that is your absorbing black body. So that this will be somebody aware that over which the radiations comes incoming. Mind it, there is a source here. There is a source here for which is giving you the radiation, maybe the sun or like this. And we want to measure the temperature. So what do you do? It's at a distance. You allow the source to be, the radiation to fall on this absorbing black body. Black body means the black body coating or something we have given as close as this one, so that it absorbs all the radiation. And if it absorbs, then what will happen? Its temperature will rise. So in that case, we use some sort of thermal detector. We use some sort of thermal detector to measure the temperature rise of this one and try to relate. So this temperature rise will be dependent on the incoming radiations, and which is again dependent on the temperature. So we claim that by measuring this temperature after proper calibration, I can measure the temperature of the source there. And that is called your broadband technique. So what are the detectors in this case in a broadband? Definitely the detectors are thermal detectors. What are they? We can say it is thermopile, special detectors. What is thermopile? Are you familiar with the term? Anybody familiar with thermopile? I guess you are not. It is nothing but it is several thermocouples in series. That means if you put several thermocouples in series, so naturally the voltage output will increase, so that we would be able to measure that small variation of temperature, because thermocouple sensitivity is normally less, and that is the thing. And so often if we want to measure using thermocouple a small change in temperature, thermopile is one of the easiest and good way for doing it. Another way is called bolometer. Bolometer is nothing but some sort of thermistor or RTD in a bridge, so that the resistance changes with the temperature and we can, and ultimately we can get a voltage or like this there. And third one is called, pyroelectric detector. This pyroelectric, so this is bolometer. Pyroelectric detector, we will not discuss right now. There are another type of detectors which have got a similar properties to piezoelectric detector. That means if light falls on it, or the light falls on it, the temperature increases and it generates some, it gets polarized and it generates some voltage there. Similar to your, the charge is generated, similar to your piezoelectric area. So the thing is, that this is a, you can understand that it requires proper calibration. That means for known source temperature, you will have to calibrate it first of all, because we don't know what is the emissivity and etc. And we need to calibrate it and then go for the unknown temperature test. Okay? Is it okay? Any question? If it is not, then we go for the second reagent. We call it narrow band technique. Okay, this narrow band, I have told, that means we will have to keep a filter through which only a narrow band of light comes through it, and then you use some optical detector. So that's why, so what we did here there, so measures in radiation at a particular wavelength only. So definitely a filter is essential of this one. So and definitely the detectors are the optical detectors. Say suppose it is phototransistor, next is that light detecting resistance. In short, we call it LDR. That means we know this is all semiconductor materials. LDR is a semiconductor material where if you, in the dark condition, it has got a resistance of few mega ohms. But once it is exposed to light, it drops down to the below 1 kilo ohm or around 1 kilo ohm like this. So a very large variation will take up those issues, the properties and the constructions and etc. afterwards. But all of them their sensitivity is dependent on the wavelength. So naturally, we allow only a narrow wavelength band to pass on it. In that case, there is a variation of this one. But another issue is already there, we have already mentioned, that if we want to measure what would be the temperature, source temperature, how can we eliminate the effect of the emissivity uncertainty? Because emissivity is a term or is a thing which we cannot really confidently say that it would be this much or like this, and because there would be always error in measurement of this one. So we look for, actually always try to make some sort of arrangement such that the uncertainty due to the emissivity factor gets cancelled out or it just eliminated. So this is a very important thing, because all the objects, whatever hot object or like this, they are all gray objects. So naturally their emissivity is not known, and that is a big problem for us. So for that one, I will present you a technique, what we call it a two color pyrometry. Often they are called optical pyrometer or radiation pyrometer. If it is in the visible range, we call it optical pyrometer. If it is in the in the wide range, even the infrared, as we have seen that most of them are in the infrared range, we call it radiation pyrometer. So what we can say, the narrow band technique, one two color pyrometer. So what we do is say, suppose this is your hot object. It comes, the light comes over here, and we have a lens which converges the light to a, what we call it, beam splitter. Okay. So we'll have some sort of arrangement. You must have seen this sort of arrangement there. The mirror and like this there, and here we put the filter. Which is of lambda 1, and here also another filter which is lambda 2. That means it's both of them are band pass, have band pass characteristics, so it is at lambda 1 and at lambda 2. Then we have a detector 1, and this we have it detector 2 there. Okay. Then we have that voltage, so we call it an amplifier to amplify the voltage. And then say, suppose the intensity of the amplifier is known as I1 here, and the intensity of the second amplifier is I2 here, and we have an arrangement which computes I1 divided by I2. Okay, and this is your output. This is your output. So we have two filters, lambda, same source, but two filters and two detectors, and amplifier and I1 and I2 are the outputs, and this one like this here. Okay. But one thing we should note, that lambda 1 and lambda 2 are very close. That means maybe one is 1500 nanometer, that is 1.5 micron, another maybe 1490 nanometer, that is 1.49 micron, or like this. So this is a very close here. So in that case, what we can say, that the sensitivity of the two detectors, that means these wavelengths are very close there, and the detector sensitivity are also almost the same there. And we know that the source is same for both of them. So we can say that epsilon lambda 1 is equal to epsilon lambda 2, because ultimately, if I say this is the path 1, this is the path 2, for both the cases, the emissivity of the source remains the same there. So we can say that, mind it, I will be doing approximation wherever possible. So in that one, I told that the Planck's law and Wien's law, there is not much difference. Rather, Wien's law is easier to implement there. So we can say that I1 is proportional to R1 lambda 1 T. T is the temperature. T is the hot object, is the temperature T there. Okay. And this one is equal to epsilon lambda 1 into RB1 lambda 1 T. So we can say that C1 lambda to the power lambda 1 to the power minus 5 divided by e to the power C2 divided by lambda 1 into T. Remind it, we have neglected that minus 1. If we put the values also, we will find that it is 1 is really negligible compared to this one. Similarly, I2, we call it R2 proportional to, sorry, R, okay. Of course, this 1 does not have any meaning, so I call it R2 comma lambda 2 T is equal to epsilon lambda 2 into C1 lambda 2 to the power minus 5 divided by e to the power C2 divided by lambda 2 into T. So mind it, these are the two things, lambda 1 and lambda 2 are very close. So detector characteristics are not different for this one there. And this emissivity of the source, because they are the same source, this epsilon lambda 1 is equal to epsilon lambda 2 there. So from that one, if we do that one, that I1 divided by I2, which I have been computing here, I1 divided by I2, it comes to be is equal to, so epsilon lambda 1 and epsilon lambda 2 gets cancelled out because they are almost the same. So big problem of tackling the emissivity uncertainty is taken care of. C1 lambda 1 to the power minus 5 e to the power C2 by lambda 1 T divided by C1 lambda 2 to the power minus 5 divided by e to the power C2 by lambda 2 to T. Okay. So this, if we do it, so many things gets cancelled out, and if we take the log natural of this one, log natural I1 by I2, actually I have not shown, actually it is log natural, you should put it there. Okay, I can make it log natural of this one. And if we do the thing, so C1, C2, C1 and etc., all will get cancelled out. And here it will nicely come up as a minus of 5 log natural lambda 1 by lambda 2 plus of C2 divided by T 1 by lambda 2 minus 1 by lambda 1. So it is a nice expression, does not have any uncertainty. So basically, if we know these things there, if we can measure it accurately and I1 and I2 accurately and know this value on the left hand side, knowing the lambda 1, lambda 2 and C2, we can easily find out what is the value of the temperature. So this is a very nice and simple property of this one, what we call it a two colors optical pyrometry or technique like this, or radiation pyrometric technique, which is basically a narrow band technique for measurement of this one there. Okay. So I stop here. And there are many other techniques also there, optical fiber type and like this there. I think, okay, I will not go to this one. Optical fiber type is also there. You can see in Bentley's book, a little more details and more techniques are there. I am sure that you would be able to understand those things there. That is a optical pyrometer, I mean the fiber optic pest. Pyrometer is there, you can find out and understand this one. I am not going into detail of it. So in a nutshell, what we can say, this is a basic techniques of a radiation pyrometer, and this is a very useful technique there. We formed a distance from how do you measure the temperature of a hot body there. And obviously in this case, because the temperature is high, so plus minus 5 degree Celsius temperature difference is not that important or like this. So now often the measurement accuracy may be in the range of 5 degrees Celsius or like this. Well, you go for 3000 degrees Celsius or like this, then it would not be yet here. But otherwise, there are several few elegant methods where you can do it. But the broadband technique is simple, but we need to calibrate it properly for against the uncertainty of the emissivity. So I stop here.